Hi everyone, welcome to another video. Today I'll be taking you through the evaluation of sleep disturbances. Now we know the definition of insomnia is where there is a subjective dissatisfaction with the sleep one experiences, and this could be either difficulty falling asleep, staying asleep, or waking up really early in the morning. This is occurring quite frequently, about 3 times a week for more than 3 months duration. Now, when we think about evaluation of insomnia, we've got to ensure that we rule out other important aspects that might be affecting sleep as a whole. So with that in mind, I'll be taking you through a quick evaluation and provide some key tips to help you evaluate sleep difficulties. Let's get started. So whenever we have sleep problems, firstly, we think about the nature of those sleep problems. Is it where the individual is finding it difficult to fall asleep, stay asleep, or early morning wakening? Now we know sleep disturbances can be quite comorbid with a number of psychiatric disorders. For example, if there's anxiety and preoccupation and worries, then people might find it difficult to fall asleep. If there's agitation, many individuals tend to have difficulty staying asleep. For example, in post-traumatic stress disorder, people can have nightmares. Many individuals with autism spectrum disorder or ADHD have significant hyperarousal symptoms at nighttime that can keep them awake. Chronic fatigue syndrome is associated with high levels of hyperarousal as well. And then there's early morning wakening. Early morning wakening can be a part of a specific type of depression known as melancholic depression or agitated depression. So it's really important to think about sleep disturbances and ruling out comorbid psychiatric disorders, because we know that sleep arousal systems are present in the brain and the same areas can be affected in a number of psychiatric disorders as well. So that's really important. So we think about the nature, and the first thing we focus on is what are the sleep habits. And in sleep habits, we take a good history of sleep hygiene. And this is really thinking about the stimuli that might be affecting sleep overall. So sleep hygiene, you know, important to wake up at the same time, go to bed at the same time. So having a reasonable routine, getting adequate sunlight during the day to establish the circadian rhythm. I've covered another video on neurobiology of sleep, so you can have a listen to that as well. And then we've got to think about, you know, what are the other routine during the day that might be affecting sleep? For example, increase in caffeinated drinks, you know, Red Bull, stimulant drinks, etc., exercising too late. And then sleep hygiene closer to bedtime. Is the individual spending a lot of time with the computer or watching television in bed, where the bed isn't associated with just sleep and intimate activities, but bed is associated with other routine activities as well. So as a result of that, the individual, the brain doesn't recognize bed as an area to sleep. So this is really important as part of sleep hygiene. And as part of sleep hygiene, we think about what's known as stimulus control and sleep restriction. Sleep restriction, some of the strategies that we use in helping individuals sleep better, you know, telling them go to bed at the same time, wake up at the same time if possible, you know, avoiding caffeinated drinks or stimulant drinks during the day, and going to bed only when you're sleepy. If you can't sleep, you know, avoid clock watching, get up, go somewhere else, come back to bed only when you're sleeping. So what you're trying to do is to condition your brain to recognize that bed's only there for sleep. So that's sleep habits. Now, if the sleep habits are okay, then we think, okay, are there any substances? I mentioned caffeine, stimulant drinks, alcohol, or cannabis, etc. If sleep affecting substances are present, then of course review it and understand why the individual might be using those and address it accordingly. On the other hand, if there are no sleep affecting substances and sleep habits are also absolutely fine, then that would be classified as insomnia. And there are different types of insomnia, such as psychophysiological insomnia, which is mainly related to, say, sleep hygiene aspects. A mild adjustment of sleep hygiene aspects can provide lots of benefits. Things such as adjustment insomnia, there might be stresses present. Jet lag is a form of insomnia. So these are all sort of time-limited aspects that can be treated with non-medication interventions. Now, short-term medication interventions can be considered to assist the individual to sleep, and we'll talk about those medications in a bit. Next, we also evaluate whether there's daytime sleepiness. And the same thing, we look at sleep habits because, of course, if the individual isn't getting adequate sleep, there will be daytime sleepiness. But excessive daytime sleepiness, we know, can be a characteristic of narcolepsy, and narcolepsy can be associated with other things such as cataplexy, sleep paralysis, hypnagogic, hypnopompic hallucinations. So this is a completely different entity, but we need to take into account daytime sleepiness because there are risks involved if the individual is feeling sleepy during the day, say for example during driving, etc. Same evaluation that we carry out, we look at sleep habits, and if the sleep habits are okay, then we look at other aspects such as sleep behaviors. But essentially, if the sleep habits are not okay, then we go through the same sleep hygiene aspects, we look at stimulus control, we look at sleep restriction techniques, so psychoeducation, etc. Now we can add other things such as cognitive behavioral therapy, specifically for insomnia. And then we've got to think about sleep behaviors, because there are certain sleep behavior disorders that can impact on or result in significant sleep disturbances. And here, conditions such as obstructive sleep apnea, we take a collateral from a family member, for example, asking whether the individual snores significantly or if the individual's had hypoxic attacks during the night where they stop breathing, for example. And many individuals, family members, are able to tell you whether that's occurring. If that occurs, obviously, referral for a sleep study becomes important. Other conditions such as restless leg syndrome, this is a really unpleasant sensation in the legs where the individual closer to bedtime feels like they need to move their legs with an unpleasant sensation and it's relieved on moving. This can be associated with, say, iron deficiency anemia, and the treatment often includes dopamine agonists. Of course, treating iron deficiency anemia at milder levels, magnesium may help. And then we have things like, I mentioned narcolepsy, and REM sleep behavior disorder. So REM sleep behavior disorder is where the individual can actually act out, as there might be complex movements that are present. Sometimes they can harm themselves or the person sleeping next to them as well. So again, for all of these conditions, a sleep study becomes important. So what this basically tells us is when sleep problems are present, we need to carry out a thorough evaluation. For conditions where sleep hygiene may be a major issue, we consider non-pharmacological strategies for that. However, if there are psychiatric disorders present, then we may need medication for those aspects. Generally in insomnia, what are the kind of things that work? So we have non-pharmacological treatments such as cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. I mentioned sleep hygiene, sleep restriction techniques, stimulus control techniques. From a medication perspective, we of course have benzodiazepines, but benzodiazepines, they do not necessarily restore the sleep architecture. They do not necessarily increase the time spent in deep sleep, which is the delta waves and the theta waves that we need for restorative sleep. So they can assist with the individual falling asleep, reduce hyperarousal, but they might not treat the core issue. Then we have what's known as Z drugs, such as Zopiclone, Zolpidem. Now some individuals can have paradoxical reactions, and there have been cases where the individual can have complex behaviors that they don't remember with Zolpidem or Zopiclone, but these can be useful agents for certain patients. Now, both benzodiazepines and Z drugs can be associated with the risk of dependence, and therefore they should be cautiously prescribed. Then we have a new group of agents such as suvorexant, lemborexant, and these are orexin antagonists. Now, orexin are the wakefulness neurons, so orexin antagonists block these, so they work through a different mechanism. Due to this, the risk of dependence is lower on these agents, so useful agents to consider. Then we have melatonin. Melatonin is a naturally occurring hormone. We know that when we're exposed to darkness, melatonin release starts. So melatonin can be a very useful agent as well. And of course, we have other sedative agents depending on the psychiatric disorder that's present. For example, if depression is present and sedation is required, mirtazapine low dose at 15 to 30 milligrams can help as well. These are some of the medications that can be used, but of course all medications should be always considered in discussion with the physician. And other medications that we talked about, for example, if restless leg syndrome is there, we have dopamine agonists such as pramipexole, Cifrol, or we have ropinirole, etc. But of course, nutritional aspects need to be looked at in restless leg syndrome. For REM sleep movement disorder, similarly, there are other agents that can be considered. For obstructive sleep apnea, treatments such as CPAP can be beneficial. So I hope that this has given you a good idea about sleep disturbances. Sleep disturbances can be due to a range of reasons, and it's important that one considers this from a broader perspective so that one can target appropriate treatments for those sleep disturbances. So with that in mind, I look forward to seeing you in another video. If you like this video, don't forget to hit the like button and of course subscribe to our channel as well. Thank you very much for your support and watching this particular video. Look forward to seeing you soon again. Bye-bye. Yeah.